understand, number two, objective, to understand the meaning of discipleship and what it means to follow Jesus. Number three, to see how our commitment to prayer, to see how our commitment to prayer is directly linked to the results we experience in life and in the ministry. Okay, I just want everybody just to look at that just for a moment, to see how our commitment to prayer is directly linked to the results we experience in life and in the ministry. All right, so if we want to actually have results in our ministry, then I think it would pay us to really take note to have a prayer life. Prayer life. This morning we spent an hour and 15 minutes with a group that comes on Wednesday. And we just focused on strengthening that prayer life. Strengthening the prayer life. And how many would like to know how we can strengthen your prayer life? And how many would like to know how you can strengthen your prayer life? Everybody said, well, I know I already know how to pray as good as I need to pray. Amen. I can pray good enough. Amen. But there are some things that we shared this morning, and it was following the example of Jesus. Things that we can do that can tremendously impact our prayer life. We're going to be sharing some of those things today. Things that we can do that will... Prayer can be very, very, very enjoyable. And sometimes people say, I just can't wait until this thing, this prayer is over. I want to get out of here. But that would be somebody that really haven't understood how to tap into the riches of God's grace through prayer. We're going to show you how to do it. And exhort you to do it. And then nobody will be looking around and watching the clock and looking wise and otherwise and wishing the prayer meeting was over. Everybody will just be rejoicing. You knew that secret. We're going to share that secret with you tonight. All right, let's look at Jesus, the apostle and high priest of our profession. Was faithful to God. And I think that all of Jesus' success can be attributed, most of it, amen, practically all of it, was the emphasis that he placed on his communion with God. His communion with God, his fellowship, and his oneness with God. How many notice that Jesus spent a whole lot of time going out before day and sometimes spending the entire night in what? Prayer. Seems like he valued prayer even more than the miracles that he was performing and the teachings that he were sharing with the world. Enjoying praying. Amen. All right, let's look at Hebrews 3:1. Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly call, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Jesus Christ, who was faithful to him that appointed him, so also Moses was faithful in all of his house. You know, all of the people that God talks about being faithful are people that really had strong prayer life. They did not feel that they were capable in themselves to carry out God's will. So they leaned very heavily on what? The ability that only God can give. So they waited on God. Amen. How many know it's a good thing to wait on the Lord? Amen. They that wait upon the Lord shall what? Renew their strength. Amen. They shall mount up as what? With wings as what? With eagles. How many want to fly? Wants to be a super salad. All right. If you want to be a holy joke, himself, he's a sky pilot. Amen. The Bible says, if we wait on the Lord, amen. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Amen. Wait on the Lord will show you every move you need to make. Amen. When we say wait on the Lord, we don't mean just what, just come to church, just do what, looking around and stop waiting on the Lord. Waiting on the Lord means that you what? You are doing something. What? You're healing yourself, right? You're opening up yourself so God can what? Speak through you. And that involves what? Worshiping the Lord. Is that right? Saying stuff. Is that right? Amen. Just to offer up continually the sacrifice of what? Praise. That's a sacrifice. Amen. Sacrifice of praise is to be offered continually. Amen. The scripture says that is the fruit of our lips giving what? Thanks to God. God wants what? Our thanksgiving. He tells us to rejoice evermore. All things what? Give thanks of the rising of the sun until the going down of the same. Amen. We are admonished to what? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So when we wait on the Lord, that means that what? We'll what? We're praising the Lord. And you're saying stuff to the Lord. Amen. You know, the Bible speaks a lot about us taking God's word and speaking God's word back to Him. Amen. How many like, some of you that had children, how many like your children come to you and say, Mom, this is what you said? If it's something good, you know, you kind of glow. Yeah, I did say that, didn't I? Since I said that, I'm gonna make that what? Yeah, I'm gonna make it good. I'm gonna stand by that. My word is what? To make sure that it comes to be what? True. Reality. So, this is part of the secret that we have in prayer. I mean, it's not really a secret, but I guess it's a secret to those that, praise God, don't see the importance of it. The secret of prayer that will really move the heart of God is prayer that you do from your heart, but you are speaking God's word back to Him in prayer. Alright. Sister Neal said, when we speak the words back to God in prayer, what will the result be? Amen. Alright, now anybody have an idea what the results might be? Alright.
But I was just thinking of that when you said that. Now, I mean, made a promise, but he didn't get it as long as he didn't come back and remind me of.
Right.
So sometimes we have to remind God of His word, and when we do, we have a right to expect, you know, if we've done what we're supposed to do. See, he followed through, and he got involved with the basketball because he's good, and I just didn't want to see him just laying out doing nothing because he's a real natural at it. And but when he reminded me of what I said, then I had to deliver. So could we not expect God to do the same?
Right. All right, Jax, they just got through talking about you.
Oh, is he here? Oh. I didn't know he was here. Was he here then?
No, he wasn't here.
Oh, yeah. But he reminded me.
We were speaking about the importance of calling God to remembrance to the things that He has promised. If we call that speaking God's word back to Him, sometimes we call it affirming God's word. And the Bible tells us that this is something that we are our profession. Y'all will definitely get this. Our profession as believers, this is what we're supposed to specialize in, is what? Consistently affirming or speaking God's word back to Him, sometimes in the form of reminding Him, or sometimes it's simply just to establish the word firmly in your heart so that God can bring that word to what? Fruition. But the scripture says God hearkened to the voice of His word, right? Right, so okay, He hearkened it. And another thing the Bible says that I create the fruit of your lips.
Do we sometimes, maybe we know all of that, mm-hmm. and maybe don't believe it because sometimes when we make each other promises, we don't deliver on those promises. And we think that we've grown, you know, if you've grown up not believing, experiencing mm-hmm. that people don't follow through what they say. Mm-hmm. And sometimes that's the way we think when we go before God. We know God has said it, mm-hmm. but it's like,
reluctance.
Right. Psalm 103:20. Okay.
That's where the enemy comes in, what you just said.
What's that?
Placing that doubt in your mind.
Absolutely.
Telling you all kinds of things like, well, you're not worthy.
Right.
You're not worthy of what you're saying or what you said.
Uh-huh.
And all of those lies
diminish
your faith.
That's it. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, okay, what we were saying earlier is that Mr. Hill, that's a good illustration she gave was that.
I hope he was not embarrassed. It was a good illustration. What was it here? So what?
He's walking in here.
Okay.
Turn it over. You,
okay, I said
you story,
a while back, I wanted him to play basketball, and he didn't want to. So I promised him a certain amount. Well, when I talked to him, I said, I'll give you X amount of dollars if you'll play. He said, no. Then I upped the ante. He said, no. Then I kept going. He said, no. And finally, he never did tell me, yes, he was going to play. But he just started playing. And then a little later on, maybe a couple of months later, he went to his dad and said, Daddy, you remember when Google promised me some money, he never gave it to me. And I said, he never asked for it. And I was drawing the illustration that sometimes when we don't ask God for what He's promised, or remind Him of what He's promised us, it's not that He won't do it. Mm-hmm. We have to remind Him. And when He reminded me, I gave it to Him.
Yeah, He's waiting for that promise to.
Yeah.
Produce faith. I mean, the faith got to be.
See, I thought he forgot it.
In other words, a person has to come to the point of acting on that promise before God will fulfill it. So I guess the tennis shoe that he needed probably trumped him to act.
That was a motivating fact. He was like,
he said, oh! Just like that.
Yeah,
just like the baker and the butler. You know, when they were in prison,
And we promised Joseph that, that they were going to tell Pharaoh about him and you have to get him out of prison. And when that never happened, but when Pharaoh sent for him to come and interpret his dream, he said, "Oh, I remember. I remember that dreamer, I mean, that interpreter, that man of God, interpreted our dream and it came to pass just like what he said." That was the thing that prompt is memory. So that's memory was prompt. And when your memory is prompt, then you'll act. And when you act, then God will what? Fulfill his word.
And from my standpoint, I wanted him to always know that if I make a promise to him, that I would fulfill it. And you know, I made him a promise and that I would fulfill it. And likewise, when God makes us a promise, we want to know that he fulfills his promise.
Okay, so this is a big, big issue in our walk with the Lord, because the scripture says that our entire walk with the Lord should be a walk of confession, of reminding God, or of praying with God, or affirming the things that God has what? Clearly promised. Amen. All of the promises in God are yea and amen, but they're not going to happen automatically without us what? Claiming them. And then we're going to have to what? Have the man take these promises and begin to what? Agree with them. And begin to release those words. Amen. Through our mouths.
Oh, that's, I forgot an element of that. It's when he went to his dad and asked him, "Did Google promise me that?" Mm-hmm. And he said, "Yes, she did, but did you ever ask her?" Mm-hmm. And that was a part of it. And he said, "No." But he called me on the phone and asked me for it. And I said, "When do you want it?" He said, "Now."
Well, the Bible says that hold fast to your what, confession of faith without wavering. That's the exact way God has intended for all of the promises that he has laid up to come to pass. Got to what? Be acquainted with the promise, and you have to what? Acknowledge it. You know, if somebody, if I had promised people saying certain things, then nobody would acknowledge, say, "Looky here, didn't you promise me this?" I would probably go as long as I could without what? Making it good. No, no, but you want to see some type of aggressive move on the person that the promise has been made to. You know, you just don't like to reward people that's passive. You know, passive and, you know, act like we have on it. You know, God's scripture says that he's a rewarder of them that who?
Diligently.
And he also says that whatsoever we desire, and desire means what, a strong yearning, a longing for something that God has promised. So God waits till that level of desire reaches a certain point. That's the importance of confessing or saying things to God and taking the word to him. Amen. So that word will be quickened and made alive. Amen. And produce the faith that it has to produce before God will make that word reality. So our walk with the Lord, I'm going to say this again, should be a walk of what? A walk of confession. A walk that we consistently affirm what God has what promised. Now, we all know that all of the promises of God are legally ours. How many understand the difference between a legal right and a vital right? Something legally yours, it could be yours for 50 years and if you never step up to the plate, if you never put forth effort, if you never call God to remembrance or do anything about it, as long as you're passive, then what? It's not going to what? Become reality. It will always remain in the realm of a legal right. But when it becomes vitally yours, that means that it becomes reality, becomes yours in reality. That means that you have to what? You have to take hold of that promise, and you got to make that promise what? Yours. Amen. Now here's how, amen, here's how you make God's promises reality, is through meditation. Everybody understand meditation? There is a side of meditation we call verbalization. What do I mean by verbalization? All right, you have to what? Speak it out. Everybody says speak it out.
Yeah.
Speak it out. Now, in these prayer meetings, I just be listening for somebody to speak something out. I just listen. Sometimes we have to what? Try to push it out, pull it out, cram it out. Because we don't feel that. We don't feel, I guess, a revelation of how important confession is to our walk with the Lord and the fulfillment of his promises hasn't really done on us quite like it should. Everybody would agree with that? See, reading the Bible, studying the Bible, all of that is wonderful, and I think that everybody ought to read every day. But meditation is more than just reading. Meditation is also more than verbalizing. It's actually also, we call verbalizing, that's one part of it, that you say it out loud. Everybody says, say it out loud. It's important for you to hear yourself. How many believe that? Faith comes by what? Here's the sermon. No, not really. It can, it does. By your teachers, sure, faith comes by you and your teachers. But faith comes more so by hearing who?
Yourself.
Faith comes by what? Hearing. And hearing by the word of God. So it's good to hear yourself. Amen. How many know it's good to hear yourself?
Yes.
Amen. That's the only way most faith is going to come is by what? The words coming out of your mouth. Because God said, I create the fruit of your lips. If you don't have no fruit coming out of your lips, out of your mouth, then there is nothing for God to what? Create. Amen. Praise God. You know, I wish we would come in agreement to the fact that the measure of God's blessings that we will experience is directly linked to the extent that we consistently what? Speak his word, or verbal speak his word, or affirm his word, or agree with his word. And I think that it should come out of your mouth. You know, sometimes people say, I'm thinking about all of that. You know, the Lord's word always stays on my mind. Well, it's good for the Lord. Now, suppose Sister Pearl told Brother John, you're always on my mind. You're always on my mind. Well, you know, Brother John, at one point, somebody going to say what? I wish it was in your mouth sometimes. I wish you would what? Affirm what you got on your mind by what? Saying it. Amen. So you have what you what? Think. You have what you what? Meditate. You have what you say, right? All right. So what you say is the way you build your world. What you say. Whatever your world is all about now, in every dimension, to a large degree, is what you have been what? Saying. A culmination of the things you have been what? Saying. So verbalization, and what was the other? Visualization. Visualization. Now these are all aspects of what? Meditation. You got to what? Verbalize it. You Because when you begin to verbalize, things begin to what? Run through your mind. Pictures, images, the things that you are speaking becomes what? It comes up on the screen of your imagination. That's how you visualize. Visualization comes from what? Verbalization. So when you verbalize things, then the pictures, and you begin to what? View the things that you're saying on the screen of your imagination. Everybody understand what I'm saying? All right. So that's the way people do in plays. People that learn to be famous actors, they have to what? Verbalize, and then they have to visualize themselves being in that particular what? Role as that particular character. They have to visualize that. As they get so good at it until they get so emotional with it. They can make themselves cry at the drop of a hat. So words are powerful. How many can say words are powerful? Y'all believe words are powerful?
Yeah.
Amen. And the Bible says this, the mouth of the upright shall what? Deliver them. How many want to be delivered? Amen. So if you want to be delivered, you're going to have to what? Begin to what? Agree with God. Everybody say, I got to agree with God. I got to what? Say what God said about my situation, my circumstance, my abilities. Amen. And what he has made me to become in him. Amen. I'm going to tell you, in the area of new creation realities, this is a big issue. Now, suppose I just haul off and say something like this. I'm complete in him. You know, to the average person, that wouldn't make any kind of sense at all. I'm complete in him. Now, what would that mean to any of you? I'm complete in him. What does that mean? I'm complete. How many believe that at whatever stage of spiritual, of your spiritual walk you're in, you can be complete? Is that right? When a baby comes into the world, is he a complete baby?
Yes.
Some say, well, he ain't got no teeth. Teeth is. Oh, Lord. All right. Well, you can't see no teeth. I don't see teeth in babies' mouth. Is there somewhere? All right. So everything that he needs to be fully equipped is what? Is in him. But they haven't really what? Materialized and became what? Visible. All right, but they are there. How many of you, something can be there and you can't see it? So a lot of stuff is there that I can't see. I can't see everything. Amen, in y'all. But it's there, right? All right, so I'm complete in him. That's what I'm going to say. I'm complete in him. Amen. I don't care how far I miss it, how much I lie. I don't care what I'm going through, what I can't do, not able to do. I still can what? Agree with the word and say I can do all things through Christ, which what? Strengthens me. Amen. I'm complete. All that I need. Basically what you're saying, all that I need is in what? Is in Jesus. He's in me, I'm abiding in him, and his word is abiding in me. He's the vine, I'm the branch. How many believe you're a branch? Somebody said, what is a branch? Amen. What is a branch? That's part of the what? Part of the vine. Part of the vine. All right. The same life. The same power, the same strength, the same ability, the same wisdom of whatever it is, whatever we need, that flows through the vine. Jesus said, I'm the true vine. Woo! I'm getting happy. I am the true vine.
Yes. Amen.
And my father is the what? Husbandman. Woo, glory. Amen. I'm glad we got out. Amen. We tapped into a true vine. True vine. Amen. Whatever's in that vine, amen, is going to be what? In the branch. Amen. But many times, what's in the vine never be fully manifested in the branch, because the branch many times is not aware of what's in the what? Of what's in the vine. Sometimes they don't even say, I'm in the vine. Amen. If you don't say it, you're going to feel like what? You're not in it. You're going to feel like you're cut off. You're going to feel like you're all alone.
Well, in the natural, my mind is clicking. In the natural, when a vine is severed or partially severed from the tree, it'll live a little while, but then it'll begin to die. You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And when it begins to die, there is no life force flowing from the vine to the branches. So, in other words, you got to stay hooked up and connected to the main source.
All right. I'm glad you brought that out. The way that we stay hooked up and connected is through what? It's through our fellowship. Amen. Man, meditation is important. You got to what? Verbally, you got to say stuff. I took somebody and just said, you gotta say stuff if you want to see stuff. If you want to see stuff, you're gonna have to what? Say. All right. So visualizing is a result of what? Saying things and calling things that be not as though they are. God begins to what? Put these images and give you a little peek of what he has for you. Scripture says, I hasn't seen. Neither ear has heard, neither has it entered into the heart of men the things that God has prepared for them that love him. But God has revealed them. He is revealing them through his what? Spirit. How many believe you can have spiritual eyes?
Amen.
And there's a difference between spiritual eyes and what? Natural eyes. When you begin to speak things and call things that be not as though they are, then your spiritual eyes can begin to what? See stuff.
Amen. Yes.
How many want to see some stuff? How many like to see like $100,000 in the next year or so? How many like to see that?
Amen.
Hey, Brother Sonny, everybody start laughing when I say that. They get very happy. But if I would say, how many would be willing to confess prosperity scriptures? Amen. 50 times a day. Amen. They will start to get, they start to get what? Very sad. I didn't think you got to do all of that. Well, you got to see it. Sister Hill always say, if you can't see it before you see it, you'll never see it. I mean, that's almost like saying about Jesus. Jesus was when Christ was when Jesus was not. But Jesus was not when Christ was not. Nobody understand what you're talking about. But if you can't see it before you see it, then you'll never see it. So you got to do some things that cause you to start seeing stuff. Amen. I want to see myself in a much better condition. I want to see myself, amen, in better circumstances. I want to see myself, amen, more successful. I want to see myself in favor with what? God and man. Amen. Praise God. But confession or verbalization is a part of meditation that we do not want to neglect. And I'm not sure whether I brought that book tonight, but I got a whole lot of these scriptures written down that I was going to talk about tonight. This little book here, I guess y'all said I got so many little books and stuff. I guess that's it. Brother Hill always, I just stopped even thinking about it. I stopped even, whenever he said book, I don't mess with these books. I hope that's not your attitude. But
I found something in this book that I really like. And it just a rebel, and it just hit me. I'm going to see how many of y'all have got it.
Yeah,
what,
the book?
Oh, no, not the Revelation. Okay, the Revelation is this. The second half of this book, it tells you everything you are in Christ, in almost every area. God's strength and ability that's at work in you. God's grace that has been released into your life. Your oneness and fellowship and your position as sons. All of that is kind of scaled out. And your rulership, what else? Priesthood. And your all of these privileges are spelled out in this little book. And another day, in morning prayers, God will really begin to deal with you in morning prayer. God saying, I want you to go back over this book and begin to reflect on the different aspects of your redemptive rights. And I want you to begin to build your prayer life. Build your prayer life around those rights and privileges that I have actually legally released into your life. It talks about boldness to enter a holy of holies through the new and living way. It talks about boldness through the blood of Jesus. That talks about all of these things, okay? Our position in his family, the importation of eternal life, for his strength and his ability in us, for our birthright privileges, our intimate fellowship he has established. All of these privileges are in this little book. And this morning, in the morning class, I began to focus very heavily on praying, using these rights and privileges that are so very clear. You know, I know that whenever you begin to talk about rights and privileges, this seems kind of abstract to people. And many times we don't understand how important it is for us to begin to agree with these things, amen, in order for our prayer life to take on a new meaning. Amen, and we can really get a breakthrough just by saying these things back to God in our prayer, amen, when we come to pray. How many can say amen to that?
Amen.
So let me just say this. The three aspects of meditation is verbalization. The second one was what? Visualization. And the other part of it is what? Y'all know? Is actualization. You got to visualization, verbalization, visualization, and internalization. Now the internalization, when the wait a minute, I got a revelation here. Y'all listen to this. Y'all listen?
Yes.
Say I'm
listening.
Cooper Page. I'm listening. All right. Now, I'm going to tell you how internalization comes in. Okay, we mentioned first the verbalization, right? Then we mentioned what? When you verbalize things, you begin to what? See yourself as what? As God has what? Have said you are. That's right. You begin to see it. How many believe that you can see more on your knees and more in prayer than you can standing tiptoe on this seat?
Yes.
amen. How many can say amen to that? Amen. You can see a whole lot on your knees when you're in prayer. That's what the Bible says, the interest of this word giveth what? Life. How many can say amen? How many can praise God for life today? It giveth what?
Understanding
to who?
The simple.
Amen. So in the presence of God, there's what? Fullness of what? Joy. The joy of the Lord is your what? In your strength. See, what happens is that when you begin to verbalize, then you begin to what? See yourself as God what? Sees you. You get a picture. Sometimes you can see the end results. I remember this years ago when I first started agreeing with God and saying what God said about me. This is what the word said, that you can ask for whatever you will, and it shall be done. I really wanted to make an impact in writing Bible study lessons, because I did it so long with people on a one-on-one basis, and I do Bible study sometimes without even picking up even a book. Because I've done the same thing over and over and over. I said, Lord, I just really wish, I'm believing you for me to be able to put into print all of the lessons that I have been teaching for 20 years on a one-on-one to people all of this time. And as I began to make that confession, and agree with God that all things are possible to him that believe. Is that right? Whatever you ask according to his will, he what? He heareth us. Know that he heareth us. Then we have the petition. And as we begin to confess these things and agree with God, then I begin to see myself, amen, going to conventions and speaking to a whole lot of folk, even pastors and bishops. I saw myself, even before I did it, I saw myself doing that. And even then, sometimes I was so ashamed of my old raggedy car. I would park it a block or two away from the church. And it was nobody, because I get up there, start talking about all of this, who I am in Christ, and all of these books and workbooks I got. So I got lessons that will cover you 5 years in your church. I have a Bible study for you every week for 5 years. And I parked my car two or three blocks away. Amen. But I saw the end result, because I was speaking what? The word of God. That's what God told Joshua. He told him, don't let the word of God depart out of your what? Mouth. But what? Meditate on it. Day and night. How many can say meditate day and night?
Meditate day and night.
Meditate day and night. Amen. So meditate means that you have to what? Verbalize it. You got to what? See it. You got to see the end result from the what? From the beginning. Before it becomes what? Reality. And then the internalization part comes with when you see the end result, when you see the potential, when you see the end of God's word, then you what? Do like Abraham. The Bible says that he grew strong in faith by what? Giving God what? Giving God praise. How many can say, give God praise? You got to give God praise before the thing that you see will ever what? Materialize. Amen. Praise God. And that's the good part, when you just can rejoice in things that are what? Seen in the spirit, but they are not seen in the what? Natural. How many know that gives God? Amen. That really honors God. When you can rejoice, calling the things that what? Be not as though they are, and because you can see them in the spirit, not in the natural, you can see that
Whatever God has promised, he's able to what? Perform. Woo, glory. Then you can just rear back and say, there has not failed one word. All of God's promises. You can pull out those scriptures, amen, right and left. Oh, his covenant. Woo, glory. His covenant, he'll never break. How many ever heard me say that sometimes in prayer? Sometimes I'm just sitting here just saying the same thing. I've been saying that for a long time. But it's, amen, it's just getting finger looking good enough because the blessings are what? And I can almost just what? Just, all right, I got to cut up. But the scripture says, by him let us therefore offer the sacrifice of praise to him, what? Continually. Woo, glory. Amen. I was praising God even when I had to park four blocks from the church. Amen. Praise God. I was calling the things that what? Be not as though they were. And I was rejoicing. I'm going to tell y'all the truth. Amen. These scriptures that comes out of my mouth make me very happy.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. All right. So yes, yes, yes. You said cut off. Yeah. All right. Okay. But by him, therefore, Hebrews 13:15. I got these scriptures set up where I want y'all to begin to practice them in your prayer time. And when we have prayer meetings, rather than getting bored or getting tired or just looking wise and otherwise or twiddling your thumbs, I want you to what? Just start what? Affirming all of these blessings that God has clearly what? Released into our lives. And we need to start acknowledging the things that God has already what? Legally. Scripture says he has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. Is that right? Then he has blessed us, he has given us everything that pertains unto what? Life. And unto what? God. Now if you would, this lesson six, amen, I don't want lesson five, but I want everybody, I want three persons to help me next week with this lesson. And but the foundation of this lesson is prayer. Jesus always confessed who he was. He always confessed what the Father was to him. Amen. So I want everybody to, amen, to, are you not leaving?
No.
She's trying to give me a hint. That's a diarrhea. Sister Irene says she thinks so. Okay, but we're going to really focus on, because I want to work with these things until we really turn this place out in prayer meetings. And he said, oh, kind of said, amen, praise God. The works that I do, they are not mine. It's the Father in me that doeth the works. I of myself can't do nothing, but it's the Father in me. Greater is he that is in me. Amen. How many believe that you can learn about 500 of these things? Let's just start with 50 and 100. Well, if you're all right, sister daughter, you start with a few. All right, and when you said those until you get very happy, until you begin to rejoice, until you can't stop praying, then we'll move on to some more. Amen. Praise God. So we just want you to, let me call somebody that will help me this lesson next week. And Sister Pearl, I want you to call three persons in this room. I'll just throw away as one. Sister Denise, will you help us next week, please? Coordinate it with them and tell them what part you want to do. Because it's no point in me having to do these lessons over and over. It's time for y'all to do them so y'all can take ownership of these lessons. Because I want y'all to get very, very happy in your walk with the Lord. I want y'all to be very, very happy. I really want to be very, very happy. Because we're complete in him. I'm we can say that. All that I need is in what? Is in Jesus. And I'm going to what? Lift him up. Amen. He's going to do great things. All right, let's all stand. The reason why I'm letting you go early tonight is because I can't say it. Let's all stand. Pray in the morning. All right. Pray in the morning is back. All right. So, Sister Pearl, you got Sister Denise, you got Sister Irene, you got Brother Wayne. Work with them and find out what portion of this they're going to do. Three of them, you need a fourth one, you can trap one more. All right. Now, you can do it yourself. She's coordinating all of the Bible studies for me. All right, now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can think of asking, according to the power that worketh in us, to the only wise God, glory, honor, dominion, and power, both now and forever. Everybody say it. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. We happen to see the love bears back. They said, amen on their honeymoon. I mean,